So, good evening again. I apologize for interrupting your conversations, but we have a bit more program this evening, including conspicuously our closing keynote from Wyoming Governor Matt Mead, who is also, not incidentally, the sitting chair of the Western Governors Association. As those of you who have been with us before on this occasion know, we try to have the sitting head of the Western Governors Association make the closing remarks at every one of these annual State of the West Symposium. But before we get to Governor Mead, we're going to hear from former Senator Alan Simpson. So, there are people who it is an honor to introduce. And there are people who it is customary to say it's a privilege to introduce. And of course, there are people who are both an honor and a privilege to introduce. And then there's that rare category of people who are the trifecta. Introducing them is not merely an honor and a privilege, but also fun. So let me tell you about Alan Simpson. Many things about him you already know. That he's the son of a respected Wyoming governor and senator, Millward Simpson. That he somehow managed to outgrow his hell-raising youth in Cody, Wyoming, and to graduate from the University of Wyoming and the Wyoming Law School. That he served in the U.S. Army, in the Wyoming House of Representatives, and the United States Senate from 1978 to 96, where he was, among other things, the Republican whip and sat on committees for Veterans Affairs, nuclear regulation, Social Security, and perhaps most notably, if I can sound a nostalgic note here, on the Committee for Immigration and Refugees, where he co-sponsored the Immigration Reform and Control Act of 1986, also known as Simpson-Mazzoli. Where are you now, Alan, in the Senate when we need you? He has taught at Harvard's Kennedy School and at his alma mater in Wyoming. So all those things about Senator Simpson, I presume you already know. But here's what you may not know. That some years ago, Alan handsomely accepted our invitation to serve on the original Charter Advisory Council the Bill Lane Center for the American West. And we were, of course, hugely gratified to have the counsel of a man so deeply rooted in the West and such a sage and accomplished public servant. That was the good news. The bad news is that Alan never once managed to attend an advisory council meeting. Now, there were always excuses, distractions like the Iraq Study Group or the National Commission on Fiscal Responsibility and Reform, which he co-chaired with Erskine Bowles of North Carolina. But at last, having run out of excuses, Alan graciously resigned from the council. Well, maybe not so graciously. He called on the phone to inform me, and I quote, "I am up to my gluteus maximus and alligators, and you know how long my legs are, so you can guess how many alligators I'm talking about." Now, I'm obliged to say, for the sake of the integrity of the historical record, those were in fact not his exact words. He actually was far more colorfully alliterative about the relation between those alligators and his anatomy. But we're in polite company here. In any case, when we determined to invite Governor Mead be our keynoter this evening, it occurred to me that I had a matchless opportunity to guilt trip Alan and put a saddle on him, as he might say, to help us recruit the governor, whom he will introduce in just a few seconds. So, Alan, I've been in touch with our guy in the Vatican, and in recognition of your performance of this important task, he is prepared to offer you a plenary indulgence for the full remission of your sins of absenteeism those years ago. And I've also consulted with the current leadership at the Lane Center, Bruce Kane, and he and the Lane Center people would be delighted to welcome you back to the Advisory Council, provided you make a better effort than last time to actually show up. So, ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm Stanford welcome to the incomparable, and I'm happy to say, so I give you the newly shriven Alan Simpson.
Well, of all the introductions I've ever had, that was most recent. I want to tell you why I got out of that. He said, we'll just send you a little preliminary material. And here's this bale, look like a bale of hay. I said, what's this? I'm not going to go through all that. Well, this is just preliminary. Then we just taper off. I said, I'm out of here. Now, okay. It is a great treat to be here. I've been given 7 minutes. I shall use them all. Because I have been here before in various... there's a screw loose in the speaker. I usually use that sometimes, but there is something screwy about this. Now, put it out there. You got it? You're not hearing the double. I have my hearing aid on. I know you don't realize that. Anyway, it's not my first time here. I, one time, was called by George Shultz, and he said, get out here. Show up. Well, I did. I was responded. It was a splendid time. And I think David was and John were a great part of that. And here I am again, not the first time. My brother went to Stanford Law School. I called him. I said, how's it going? He said, it's great. They only give one test a year. I said, well, that's terrific. What are you doing? He said, I'm playing guitar at the Hungry Eye in San Francisco. And he moved on. He moved on from here to his chosen profession, which is teaching, and he took a degree in history. Some guy got me when I came in. He says, God, I hope you won't tell the same old jokes. I said, I don't need new jokes. I need new audiences. So I'll tell you a quick one. Everybody's talking about politics. The word politics, poly, that word comes from the Greek. They gave us words like democracy, and poly meaning many, and tics meaning blood-sucking insects. So, then I tell you about the old coot. This guy's over 60. He's in the gym working on his abs so he can get out and troll for the dollies. And this gal came in with her yoga outfit, and he went over to the trainer. He said, God, he said, what machine should I get on to really impress her? And he said, the ATM. So, and then I had one other new one, and that's, I have 5.5 minutes left. This couple, Nauvoo Rich, they came into big money and they moved to the seaside, and their beautiful daughter was washed into the surf, and the handsome guard dragged her back later there, and the mother cried out, give her artificial insemination. And the father said, we got money now, give her the real thing. That's enough of that. It's now serious stuff. It's really, this is a rare privilege for me to introduce this splendid friend and our governor. His family has deep roots in the West. You'll hear those Western themes. His forebears came to Jackson in the 19th century. His lineage is one of public service. His grandfather, Cliff Hansen, was governor and U.S. senator, as was my father. They were great friends, both born in Jackson, Wyoming. They always told one story, wherever they were, about the governor. This old guy is going down the road in his pickup. Got everything he owns in there, and the cop stops him. Said, you're speeding. The old boy said, I didn't believe that. Well, he said, "You are," and he asked him a lot of questions. He said, "Now, haven't you got a governor on that truck?" And he said, "Nope." He said, "That's manure you smell." And they got a lot of mileage out of that. So then Matt's mother ran for governor of Wyoming at one time. He was U.S. attorney for our state. Here's a couple of special social notes he doesn't know I'll toss in. His father, Pete, was the Marlboro man in those early ads sitting around the campfire, you know, Pete Mead, there he was, before the guy with the white hat. And his aunt was Andrea Mead Lawrence, who won the gold medal twice at the Olympics as a great skier. Little social note. Now, Matt is in his second term as governor, and of course, chairman of the Western Governors. And he's going to share some things tonight that are tremendously vital to us in the West and you in the West. Conflicts and concerns, those of us out here understand and other people don't. The issues are daunting and the solutions are wanting. But this remarkable man will share with you his vision of how we get the job done because he is savvy, smart, warm, wise, witty, and a patriot, which is a rare find in the present vast wasteland of sensible, effective, and respected public figures. And he has the duty to handle this staggering array of executive orders coming down and regulations from this administration, seemingly almost more directed to the West, toward us in the West than to other regions of the United States. That's either a curious anomaly or a direct intent, I don't know which. Whatever it is, this fine governor has stepped forward with his attorney general and cabinet consisting of the other four statewide officials, and chosen to take on and confront this nameless, faceless bureaucracy and agencies that know little of the volatile issues of the West. After all, 52% of our surface is owned by the federal government. They are our landlord. It's hard to sue your landlord, but he does that beautifully. And we have to do that or we'd be sucked up. And little seems to be known in the vast eastern expanse of our nation about the real issues of the West. Energy, development, coal mining, pipelines, endangered species, wolves, grizzlies, and water. We're the headwaters of all the great rivers of the world. You'll always be wanting some of our water. Water is a very emotional issue in the Western states. We often say in Wyoming, whiskey is for drinking and water is for fighting over. You will learn of the full impact of what this fine young man has had on Wyoming and the West. He's an honest broker. He does not get trapped in ideology and extremism. He has all the attributes you think you can still might recall in the wonderful book, The Virginian. Do anybody read The Virginian by Owen Wister? The hero there is a steady, calm, thoughtful, caring, wise guy with a great guts and courage, ever without flaunting those noble traits. And Matt Mead has those high personal values that are not on his sleeve. They're not worn there. He has a tremendous loyalty to his native state. And he vowed when he first ran for governor that he would make us very proud. And he has done just that. And his pride and loyalty to our state are as deep as the tap roots of his family. In Wyoming, we really bust our buttons when we see him taking on things on the national scene, on the national stage, things of vital concern to us in the West. He's a true spokesman for your state as well as mine. And beneath that gentle, kindly, direct demeanor that you see before you, I'm not going to look down, lovely demeanor. Beneath that, you will find there lurks the heart of a scrapper, a warrior, a citizen first, an office holder second, a man that's a fighter from the word go, a man of action and not reaction, a patriot and not a panderer, a lot of those guys out there. And like the lead character in The Virginian, when the evil outlaw Trampas, remember that scene? He was at the poker game and he looked over and he said, "It's your bid, you son of a bitch." And the Virginian slowly slid his six gun out on the table and in a steely, calm voice said, "When you call me that, smile." And so here he is, so listen up and smile. I love this guy, you will too.
Well, thank you, Senator Simpson. It's a delight to be here with all of you. What a special event and a special venue. I was thinking on the way here that if my high school teachers knew that I was coming within a mile of Stanford, they would think something's gone horribly wrong in the universe. But I'm delighted to be here, and what a privilege to be introduced by Al Simpson. Al, as you would expect, is one of Wyoming's finest statesmen. And he's also, I think, probably the most famous native son of Wyoming ever. And I recognized this growing up, but I recognized it more after I was first elected governor. So when I was first elected governor, took office in 2011, and my wife and I had an occasion to go to Manhattan because I had some meetings there. And they had arranged for us, Carol and I, to go to a very, very nice restaurant, the kind that, you know, has an overabundance of forks. So coming from Wyoming, this nice restaurant, and they had arranged it so that the manager knew we were coming. And Carol and I were all excited about it, and we get there, and the manager meets us in this most professional manner. Not cold, but just professional. And very early on, as we just arrived, he says, "Do you know Al Simpson?" And I said, "I do." And then it was like, "Would you like a free bottle of wine? Would you like their favorite seat?" So it had nothing to do with me being governor, but the fact I knew Al Simpson, I was on the A-list. So I recommend to all of you, wherever you go, just say, "Hey, I know Al Simpson."
It worked.
Given his formidable sense of humor, it's always a treat to hear from him, and always, may I say, adventure to be on the stage after the senator. Now, in Wyoming, Al is certainly known for his wit. But he is beloved in Wyoming, not just for his wit, but for his character. And I want to share with you a story that Al doesn't share, but I do. My first election in the primary, it was a hard-fought primary, and one of the other candidates was Al's son, Colin, a great man and in his own right. And the night of the primary, it was a tight race, and it went late into the night. And Carol and I went to bed late that night. And we were awakened early the next morning by the sound of a ringing telephone. And I answered the phone. And it was Al Simpson and his lovely wife, Ann, a great partner of his for many years, to offer sincere congratulations and to offer anything they could do. He said, "Matt, I'll get in the car, I'll walk, or I'll stay out of it, whatever you think is best." That's a man of true character. He is a statesman, and that is a rare thing these days. And so what a privilege for me to be governor of Wyoming, where I can look to somebody and say, "That's how you do it right. That's Senator Al Simpson. Senator, wonderful to have you here. So that's a good jumping off point, because the senator embodies all those things that we so much appreciate in the West: the character, the humor, the integrity, the work ethic. And so my job tonight is to talk about the West. And so before I do that, as I get into it, I want to try to paint a little bit of a picture of my lens, my perspective, because I freely admit I have a very strong bias towards Wyoming and a very strong bias towards the West. That is because I'm a fourth, before I got into this business, I'm a fourth generation Wyoming rancher. The West is near and dear to me on a personal level. I am a Western governor. I'm in my first year of my second term. I'm chairman of the Western Governor Association, which is a wonderful organization that includes 19 of our Western states and three flag islands. I see the West as special, one that is young in historical terms, and the one that will continue to flourish. So to start this, I want to use a little bit of my family history to begin the discussion of the state of the West. I grew up with the importance of land stewardship drilled into me from an early, early age. Through my great-grandparents, grandparents, and parents, stewardship was key. And they expressed it in these terms: in Wyoming, where you find one blade of grass, leave two. That has application beyond agriculture. It is, in fact, the duty of all of us to leave the place we come from a little better place. That tenet was passed on by my great-grandfather and grandmother, who settled in Jackson, Wyoming, in the early 20th century. Their life, the pioneer life, was hard. My great-grandparents, like others who came to the West in the early days, were on their own, in rugged territory, in every season, nearly winter, winter, and still winter. Like most pioneers, they relied less on government and more on grit, guts, and some good luck. But they persevered and they stayed on. Now, I have brought with me one of my favorite family photos. I think. So what you see here is, this is my great-grandmother. And sitting on the blanket with her is my grandfather, Cliff Hansen. This is with a cow covered wagon in the background. The rest of the cowboys had moved on moving the cattle. This picture was taken a little less than 100 years ago. And my grandfather, Cliff Hansen, the boy in the blanket, as a kid, had a debilitating stutter. In fact, few could understand him other than close friends and family. And as a young boy, he was sent home one day from school with a note on his shirt for my great-grandmother to read. And the note said that Cliff was no longer welcome at school because he was uneducable. He was too dumb to learn. My great-grandparents did not accept that judgment. They saved up money, and there was a day when my great-grandfather and grandfather rode horseback from Jackson Hole, Wyoming, to an area near Lander, Wyoming, Hudson. And there my grandfather, as a young boy, was put on a train by himself to go to a very special school in Indianapolis, where he met a very special teacher who taught him to start slowing his speech down. By every syllable, he would move his arm like this. And when Granddad came back after going to that school and practicing, he was very proud that he could start speaking more slowly. And so when he was herding cows, the other cowboys, in, I think, a good-natured fashion, used to say, "Look at Cliff back there. He's always talking. He's always talking. Cliff thinks he's going to be governor someday." And Granddad, in fact, got into public office. He was a county commissioner. He became the president of the Wyoming Stock Growers Association. He did become governor of Wyoming. And ultimately, he had the privilege to become a two-term U.S. senator. And great pals with Alan Simpson. And I can tell you, just one of the most brilliant speakers I've ever listened to. So the next picture is my grandfather on the left. And there he's standing with a very distinguished Wyoming citizen, Al Simpson's dad, Millward Simpson. Millward, as the senator pointed out, had a distinguished career as governor and U.S. senator as well. And as a coincidence, if Millward Simpson was alive today, this would be his birthday. Happy birthday to your dad, Al. These old photos and relationships inspire me for a number of reasons. They are my history, but they're also the West's history. It's what makes up the West. They show the West in formative days. They show the promise the West held for so many families. And they remind us how far the West has come and the people have come in a relatively short period of time. And most importantly, this history shows us how the special place we call the West can move into the future. We speak in this country of the American dream. But in the West, we also speak of the Western spirit or the frontier spirit. It is that spirit that will leave us not trying to predict our future, but instead being able to build our future. Some more about the West. Like Wyoming, most Western states saw a push for settlement and statehood from the mid-19th century to the early 20th century. Arizona was the last of the 48 contiguous states to become a state in 1912. Like Wyoming, the West at that time was sparsely populated, explored by the daring, painted by romantics, and a railroad ran through it. It was a vast, untamed area of great beauty, great resources, and great opportunity. With a trifecta of beauty, resources, and opportunity, the West advanced quickly. Now, while the East got a head start on us, the West has caught up both in terms of economic and political influence. We caught up because we have so much to offer. We caught up because now, as in the early days, we have the same solid underpinnings, beauty, resources, opportunity. These are the things we have that would support and advance the region. We Westerners took these years to take all that we were given, great raw material, through good stewardship, improved on it, positioning the region well for the future. The West is now America's food basket, California above all others. The West is now energy central. Oil, gas, coal, wind, solar power, hydropower, uranium are abundant. The West draws millions of visitors annually. The grandeur of the West that inspired generations of artists to come and paint now inspires millions of people to come and see. The West is not only young in history, it has a youthful, positive outlook. We draw innovators, researchers, educators, entrepreneurs. Through technology, and California is the vanguard, the West has and is changing the world. I was elected chair of WGA in June, and I'll serve in that capacity for 1 year. The WGA not only represents the West, it's a dynamic, effective organization. We are a collaborative group of governors, Republicans and Democrats. The unwritten rule that we follow for us is progress trumps politics. We realize the common challenges that we face in the West, for example, water issues, wildfires, infrastructure, power needs, public lands, and endangered species. Western governors know how the West was won, and we know what it takes to keep the West winning, to keep thriving. We must meet these challenges. Paralysis by partisanship holds no appeal. Rather, we seek areas of agreement, and we press on. Past WGA initiatives have included a drought forum and transmission planning. My chairman's initiative is the Endangered Species Act and how we can reform it. We started this process this morning in coding with one of four or five listening sessions throughout the West. We will have one in Idaho, we will have one in Hawaii. Just examining the Endangered Species Act very simply. Started in 1973, bipartisan effort. Bipartisan effort to recognize this country needs to do a better job protecting endangered species. Since it was enacted in 1973, There's been 2,220 species listed. Of those listed, only 30 have been delisted because they've recovered. That's less than 1.5%. By any standard, when you're at 1.5%, you are not successful. My goal with the Western Governors Association, working with the Western Governors, is to see if we can do a better job for predictability, for our industries, for our businesses, but also, importantly, to do a better job for species. When we can't reach the goal line on a species that has fully recovered, we're ignoring species and habitat that need our help. And that is what we see with the Endangered Species Act. The Endangered Species Act is meant to help those things that are threatened. And to date, too often, the only species it's been helping is something that's not endangered, and that's attorneys. We need to make improvements. The West remains strong. While diverse in resources and politics, and it is diverse in politics, you may not be surprised to learn that Governor Brown and I would not agree on everything. But each state has unique strengths that contribute to the whole. A few examples. California, as you know, is a powerful force in tech, ag, and education. Nevada, you know, is key for water with the Hoover Dam. But you may be surprised to learn that Nevada is the number one producer of gold in this country and second only on the planet to South Africa. Washington, of course, is well known for Boeing and Microsoft. And my wife would say, thankfully, for Starbucks as well. Wyoming is strong. And when I was asked to give these comments, I was cautioned a number of times before I got here, just don't talk, you can't just talk about Wyoming. You have to talk about every state. Because past governors just talk about their state. And I'm like, well, I'm going to talk about my state. How do you not talk about your state? And so I'm trying to talk about the West overall, but I have condensed a little section here where I want to talk about wonderful Wyoming. Wyoming is strong. Wyoming is the number one coal producer. We produce slightly less than 400 million tons per year. We produce far more than any other state. We are number one in coal. We're number one in uranium. We're number one in trona. Trona is soda ash. It's used to make things like detergent, and it's used to make glass. The soda ash from Wyoming is so huge. The soda ash people in Wyoming will tell you that anywhere you go in the world and you look at glass, whether it's your drinking glass or your windows, there's about a 25% chance it came from Wyoming trona. That is how big Wyoming trona is. We're number one in bentonite production, number two in helium production, top 10 in oil and gas production, and we have the best onshore wind in the country. If Wyoming were a country, it would rank as the third largest energy exporter in the world. That's the amount of energy Wyoming produces and exports. But we're also rated by the U.S. Chamber of Commerce as having the third best business climate in the country. We have the lowest taxes of any state. We're ranked number two for entrepreneurial startups. We have just built over the last couple of years 100 gigabit backbone across the state for broadband connectivity. We have great wildlife, natural beauty, and we have been ranked the last 4 years running by Wall Street 24/7 as the first or second best run state in the country. On top of all this, we have Al Simpson. What a state. That's just a small sampling of Western diversity. We've come a long way from the covered wagon era, and we've just begun to tap the West's potential. But in order to do so, there are issues that we need to address. Energy, water, infrastructure, highways, transmission, the environment, healthcare, education, to name a few. I'll briefly touch on some of those. With great distances, energy infrastructure remains a challenge in the West. California, for example, as you know, has a very robust renewable energy portfolio and target. And some see wind as the solution. Wyoming has the best onshore wind. We are preparing to build in Wyoming the nation's largest wind farm. But providing the infrastructure to get Wyoming wind electrons to California and other states is problematic. We've been going at this for years. We have the wind. California wants these wind electrons, but we can't get the transmission. For those of you who believe that renewable energy is the solution, or at least a big part of the solution, if we can't have the ability in the West for transmission projects to be done in a timely fashion, it increases the cost and it increases the likelihood that additional projects won't be done. Can you give me water? Thank you. We have to, in Wyoming and in the West, we've got to do a better job on energy infrastructure. Highways. Highways are a big issue in the West, particularly in Wyoming, but not limited to Wyoming. Wyoming is the smallest state in terms of population. We have about 583,000 people in the whole state, but we're one of the fastest growing states last year because somebody had triplets, and I think that's wonderful. Highways are an issue for commerce, for tourism, even healthcare and education. We need good roads in the West. And I'm grateful for an interstate highway system. But we have to ask ourselves, if we did not have the interstate highway system now, and we said we're going to build it now, would we ever be able to have a great project like that done in this country now? I doubt that it is so. In Wyoming, we recognize roads are expensive, but not having good roads is even more expensive, and we've addressed it in our state. Agriculture. This is, of course, close to me as a fourth-generation rancher, but we need to be able to make sure in the West that we meet the future food needs, not just for the West, not just for the country, but for the world. And there's pressures from development, with fewer young people getting into agriculture, with water challenges, we are challenged to make sure we have food that it meets the needs of the citizens for the future. It's a national security issue. Imagine the leverage another country or countries would have on us if they were both our fuel tank and our food bank. The West should recognize the economic value and the national security value of being able to feed our citizens in the West, in the country, and around the world. Which leads me to energy. I understand you had a discussion today about energy and then coal, and I want to continue that discussion. We're bogged down on this issue of energy as it comes to climate change. The good news on this, if there's any good news in my mind on the issue of climate change, is that in some ways the brightest minds on both sides of the debate have found new and innovative ways to diminish any who disagree with their view. We're not making progress on this as we should, because we are bogged down in trying to figure out who's on which side, and we're calling each other names. Science is not determined by vote, consensus, popularity, or political pressure. Science needs to have its own way, and we need to move on this issue, because regardless of where one comes out on climate change, let's recognize this, that meeting energy demands is key for the West, for the country, and the world. In improving the efficiency and the environmental friendliness of all energy sources can be a goal without reaching a resolution on climate change. We think that should be the goal of Wyoming, and we think it should be the goal of the West. Let's move forward. We don't have to resolve that debate to move forward to make energy as clean, as efficient as possible. I believe, as others do, that we should have all above approach with regard to energy. And in that, I believe we should continue in the West, in this country, to use coal. It's unrealistic to believe that the single largest source of electricity in this country, coal, which produces slightly less than 40% of electricity in this country, is not going to be around for a long time. And once this is recognized, our efforts and dollars should be how to improve it rather than destroy it. In Wyoming, we get great benefit from coal. There's no question about it. But the coal we provide, electricity we provide to 30-plus states, they too get the benefit of affordable energy. There's a target on coal. There's no question about it. The responsibility goes with the states that produce coal to make it better, to make it more efficient. We get the benefit of coal. We're taking on the responsibility of how to improve it. We're spending money, time, and effort to do that in Wyoming, and I'd be happy to go into that further. But as the West goes, we are strong, we have challenges, we see them as opportunities, not as roadblocks. We're far from the covered wagon days, but along with beauty, resource, and opportunities, we have kept that frontier spirit, and we must never lose it. We've kept the understanding of the value of stewardship. We appreciate that each of us has a job to leave another blade of grass. So the questions are, where's our next frontier, our next Oregon Trail, the next folks with vision and tenacity to go into uncharted territory? Our predecessors had intestinal fortitude to get us to where we are now. We need the same grit going forward to leave the West a better place for our kids and our grandkids. The next explorers must find solutions for water, infrastructure, energy, ag, how to improve the environment. The next explorers will take the promise and potential of the West to the next level. The journey is already underway, and these are exciting times for the region and every state in it. Thank you for having me. I'd be happy to answer questions. Thank you.
Very nice. Nice. I'm going to get far on the end. Oh. Way on the end.
I got, what do you want to manage again? This
any tough questions, I'll give to him.
Well, I'd like to exercise the privilege of being the moderator by asking the first one or maybe even two questions. Senator Simpson, I'd like to address the first question to you. Both of you have spoken eloquently tonight about this thing you've both called the Western spirit. So I wonder, Alan, if you could just say something about what you think sustains that spirit in the life of the West today and what endangers it.
Well, what sustains it is the fact that we get to know each other. When you're from a huge state, you don't get to know your elected representatives. You walk down the street, guys come up and say, "Hey, Al, did you vote like that for you, big boob?" You know, and so you get the flavor of how the natives feel. And we work with each other as Democrats and Republicans. We don't demonize the other party. That's what's happening in Washington, and it's a sad thing to watch. But I think there is a sense of personal integrity. I've never been indicted. I'm not an adulterer. And if you ask people what's a politician, they're a horny, rotten, corrupt son of a bitch. That's what's out there, you're going to get what you get. But that's not the way it is. And so many in our commission, I was startled. I'd say, well, okay, you got five Dems and five Republicans, one independent. You did a 67-page report in English using words like going broke and no shared sacrifice. Well, who was on the commission? Who voted for this? Well, Dick Durbin. Dick Durbin of Illinois, that commie? Oh, Jesus. Well, Tom Coburn voted for Coburn, that Neanderthal Republican from Oklahoma. That's your country right now. I didn't answer your question, but I got a lot off my chest.
Governor, would you like to get anything off your chest along these lines?
I don't know if I do or not. Well, I would say a couple things. One is, I think the senator's right, is that there is an advantage in terms of knowing that you were going to be held accountable, not by polls and by only the press, but the advantage in Wyoming we see is, you know, the opponent you have today is your friend tomorrow. And I think that leads to a cordiality that is important in getting things done. When we can't listen and sit and hear from people who disagree with us, that, I think, is a threat to sort of what we see as Western spirit. Because I think in Western spirit, it is also part of that is accountability. And one of the great pictures I keep in my office is when my mom ran for governor against a very popular, wonderful man who is a Democrat. During the height of the election, when the heat was on, there's a picture of my mom dancing with the incumbent governor, both of them smiling, both of them laughing. And to me, that is an important message, because as I see Washington now, when they don't stay there, when they don't break bread together, when they can't have these serious discussions, we're not getting done what we need to get done. And I mentioned, you know, I ran against Colin, the senator's son. And as things can get odd in a state with 580,000 people, he used to date my sister. And I'm not sure who my sister voted for. So you have to mind your P's and Q's.
What I hear you both saying is something about the importance of civility and trust and cooperation and compromise, all things that, if I'm hearing you correctly, you think are woefully lacking in the national scene, but maybe have a little more vitality in the West than elsewhere. Let's hope that's true. But how can we do better than that in this region? What are the mechanisms or the platforms for better regional civility, trust, cooperation? The Western Governors Association, I just put it to you as a question, is it or is it not an effective body for
I think it
regional
is.
Cooperation?
I think there's lessons to be learned from it. I mean, we have, if you look at myself, Governor of Wyoming, you look at Governor Brown of Oregon, Governor Brown of California, Governor Inslee, I have fundamental disagreements with them on, for example, the issue of coal. But we share agreements on the issue of, you know, we have to work on water issues and drought issues together. We have to work on the forest health issues together. And because the West is not, you know, our wildlife and our habitat don't recognize state boundaries, you know, there's a connection there. Our wildfires don't recognize state boundaries. And you see in the West, for example, wildfires on the West Coast this year, you know, the calls to Wyoming, do you guys have extra help? We provide it, and they would provide it to us. And I think the Western Governors Association and that ability to recognize you can have differences with somebody, but that doesn't mean you have to dislike them, and that you always are going to have things of interest and common interests, and you can work on those together. That's the model to me. And an appreciation for the fact that as much as you believe in something, you always have to allow for the possibility you may be wrong. So keep an open mind.
So are there upgrades that could be made to the Western Governors Association, or should we work on creating other forums or platforms to enhance this kind of cooperation and respect and trust, or not?
Well, it's we have a group in Wyoming that's working on a project called Civility Matters, because it does matter. I think the Western Governors model, I wish we would see more members of Congress take that into account. When my grandfather was in the U.S. Senate, one of the hallmark legislations for him was to get more mineral royalties back to the state, to move it from, I think it was 36.
Took it to 50.
And took it up to 50%, which is a huge boon for all the states. But the only way he got that done was with the Democrats working across the aisle. And the president at the time wasn't even too fond of it, who was a Republican, but he got it done with the Democrats. And if we're going to address issues of immigration, if we're going to address issues of national security, we have to have the whole team, and that's Republicans and Democrats both.
Okay. Well, I'd like to open it up to questions from the floor. If you'll put your hand up if you'd like to be recognized and wait for a microphone to reach you. And if I can make the usual admonition to please make it a question. Pat Shea.
That was not something that was a good idea. Why can't we get back to seeing a cooperative relationship between the federal government and the state government?
For those of you who don't know, Pat Shea is the former head of the Bureau of Land Management, which is the single biggest federal landlord in the West.
Right, and the question was, why can't we get back to that cooperative relationship between the federal government and the West? It's a big issue in the West. We're 50%+ owned by the federal government, states like Utah, Nevada, much more federal land. And I think the issue is, I think too often from a state's perspective, is that things are done at a federal level in Congress and in the agencies that don't have an appreciation for, you know, we in the West, we are not part of a national park. The national parks we view as part of our states. And it is the role of every governor to try to address issues in our states. And when we have this federal land and we see whether it's challenges from endangered species or whether it's issues on transmission or issues on permitting that don't coincide with what's really going on in the ground, when we have our own federal employees, BLM or Forest Service in the state complaining about the role in Congress, it does create a lot of stress on Western states. And it's not a good thing because now you see Western states saying, hey, we need to get rid of these public lands. And I don't think long-term that's a good thing for any of the states. What was referred to in terms of the Grand Tetons, there was granddad and others in my family, that was back then. They rode horseback, actually with rifles and everything else, to protest the park becoming what it is today. Granddad said years later, he was on the wrong side of that, and how fortunate it is he lost because we now have Grand Teton National Park. But that isn't an issue of necessarily just of the federal-state conflict. I think it's, in my mind, an issue of being able to admit when you're wrong.
Yeah, I might add, Bruce Kane and David Freiberg, where are you, David? They're back there still? Over here? And I are three-fifths of a teaching team that teaches an undergraduate course here every year on the West. And one of the things we teach about is this issue of federal landlordship in the region. And I remember giving a lecture about it just last year, and about the, it's showing some graphics that show just how much of the West actually is controlled by the Bureau of Land Management and the Forest Service, the two big ones. And a student came up to me afterwards, he's from Sonora County, a rural county in California. And he said, you know, this is the first time in confronting this that I've understood what really gripes all my redneck neighbors. Because the federal presence, especially in rural districts and in predominantly rural states, is an everyday presence. So it's not only that the East doesn't get the West, it's the metropolitan West doesn't get the rural West and doesn't get how real on a daily basis is the presence of the federal presence in the lives of people out there in the interior West in particular.
It's every day.
Yeah.
I was telling this gentleman that the BLM is much more responsible now than it was when I was there, because the thing that caused the pain would be you have a lease and the BLM is out there. No community can grow in Wyoming unless they grow into BLM land. And so they give you the biggest song and dance as if you're going to put a temple out there. The BLM administers sagebrush. The Park Service and the Forest Service are taking care of the crown jewels. And the BLM is huge stretches of magnificent brush. And so the guy gets a permit and he puts up a fence, and they come and tell him in a year that he's 6 inches off and to take his fence up and move it. But I tell you, that was 25 or 30 years ago. They took guns into the BLM office at Worland, and it was tough stuff. It's called the Sagebrush Rebellion, you may remember.
Yes. Yeah.
So they're more rational, they're more understanding, and then the state has gone ahead and done its own plans on the Endangered Species Act and whether, you know, sage grouse can be saved, and they can, and the feds came in and said, your plan is good. That comes from this governor. He's working ahead of the game, but when you get lied to and you're told that if you if there are 692 grizzly bears, that it, and they get to that population, you're going to delist. And the minute you get there, plus 10% more, they go to their favorite federal judge and overturn it. That really burns people's butt, I can tell you. And then wolves, if they'll, let's see, you get 1,232 breeding pairs of alpha and beta wolves, you know, whatever they're doing. Well, a breeding pair will eat 72 ungulates a year, and their prey base is moose. You don't see any moose around Wyoming anymore. They've eaten them all. Mm. So they got to this level, and they said, now, when it's at this level, we'll turn it over to Idaho, Montana, Wyoming, and the wolves will be controlled by the Game and Fish Commission and kept at a level of appropriate, the figure you gave us. And they went right to court to their best federal judge. They all know where these guys are stacked up. They all have a form where they kiss up to the judge. And usually some person, they say, well, the grizzlies are all going to die because there's no pine nuts. Hell, they'll eat a tin can if they can. And they go to a different diet wherever they go. They're carnivores, and they eat. And they're alive, and they're well, and they're in town. And that ain't going to last long, because I'll tell you who will win that one. It won't be the grizzly. And you have the national organization, the National Fish and Wildlife, saying, stop, delist, and you can't get it done. Well, I tell you, those groups, we'll get them eventually. The Greater Yellowstone Coalition is as bad as the AARP. Of course, that's a different subject. I didn't mean it quite, well, I did mean it. Anyway, it's
tough. Do you want to add
that?
No, I think that's a good example of many of the frustrations the West has with some of the federal agencies. One of the particular more egregious ones in Wyoming is EPA has come in and looked at the Wind River Indian Reservation and has said that the boundaries are wrong. And by a stroke of a pen, they notified us after the fact. They've just changed the boundaries of our state and the jurisdiction, including the city of Riverton, which previously was not, which has a whole host of issues, not limited to, I don't like waking up in the morning finding out somebody has just diminished the amount of state ground we have. But on top of that, jurisdictional issues. People who were tried and convicted of murder in the city of Riverton under state law. Now, years after the fact, they're in prison. They wake up and find out, hey, you didn't have jurisdiction to prosecute me. Those are egregious examples of federal overreach.
Don't you see, Matt, too? I don't see Wyoming part of this thing where we want to get the states to take over the federal lands. Now that's this guy with the gun in Nevada, you know. He's really something. I don't know what his name is.
Ivan Bundy.
They all haul their hardware out there, you know, and they're kind of an interesting group. I always say to them, if your horse drops dead, it's better to get off, but they don't do that. but they were not part of that. That would be a disaster if you say, all the states should get in here and take over the federal land. That, and you know what'll happen to it. It won't get preserved. It'll be developed. But yeah. That's out there. It's out there.
Arthur Wyckoff.
Senator and Governor, thank you very much. I'm a Westerner. I was born in California and raised in the state of Washington. My husband and I raise hay that exports to Asia, and we also raise hay that is fed across our road to our neighboring bison herd that is a crop, a harvest that's a remarkable business, does very, very well. We spend a lot of time in the land conservation business, and I would say ultimately the West and the public lands, not just the federal, but the public lands are truly the icon of our patriotism, that we stand on this land and we can be proud of it. And I'd like to know how you would address the next two generations down in being as connected as you are to this landscape, because I'm very, very concerned about the children and understanding what nature and the wildlands and the resources and the businesses that are associated with it, how they stay connected to carry on the commitment to what is the spirit of the West.
Well, thanks for the great question, and I think it's a legitimate concern. I think we, it oversimplifies it, but we see too many of our young people who are spending their time on inside on TV and gaming and everything else. The only way we're going to be able to have the preservation and the landscapes and the, all that goes with that, and it's not just we like to look at it. Frankly, for Wyoming, where our number two industry is tourism, we need to be able to have all that goes with those open spaces. So one of the things we certainly do in Wyoming is a number of different initiatives trying to get our young people outdoors to have an appreciation of. And this may seem to some of you an odd thing, but I think one of the key things for conservation and for wildlife and for habitat is an active hunting program. And that is so because it is the sportsmen, hunting, fishing, people who fish, that provide so much of the funds that preserve that. And also, it's one of the best ways to get an appreciation for what that land is and what it means and how important it is to make sure that it is there for your daughter and your grandchild. And so we see that in Wyoming. When we in the state or the federal government starts going in a direction, it is the sportsmen who come out of the woodwork and say, we want public land. We want access to these public lands. But it is certainly, as you pointed out correctly, it is part of the heritage of the West to have that, because you don't see that in the same way on the East Coast. And the key is to get the next generation. And I know some of you here may not hunt, but we do. And I think that is one of the keys to get the young generation outdoors and to have an appreciation for all the outdoors brings.
I think the thing that always got me was the paternalistic attitude of people who would come to Wyoming and say, well, you need to do this and you need to do that. And I said, well, why are you here? My family's been here for six generations. Why the hell do you think it looks like this? Because we've taken care of it. And don't forget, in Wyoming, we have the Stock Growers Land Trust, we have the Green River, we have many of these private trusts who are giving the landowner his or her money, and they can continue to ranch. And we have easements, we have a good set of state laws, and every year they'll send you, say, we just picked up another 250 acres, or we picked up 1,000 acres, and there are a lot of those happening in Wyoming, and so the ranching stays, and they get their money and head for Sun City, and the kids stay, and if they don't, it belongs to the environment.
I'd add that in Wyoming, we have all those great groups, Nature Conservancy, Stock Growers Trust, but the state of Wyoming itself, we have been building up, we want a $200 million endowed fund to also preserve open space. It's I think, unique among states that we're trying to have an endowed fund to address just that, to provide, in particular, ranches to stay as ranches versus ranches being malls. And we haven't reached the $200 million mark yet. We've got about $100 million in there, but it's something we continue to work on.
So we have made a promise to get people out the door by 8:45. We're approaching that. Bruce, I'm going to take the privilege of the chair and recognize the gentleman back here for one last question. Yeah, Bill.
Governor Mead, my name's Bill Chapman, Senator Simpson. There was some discussion this afternoon about how to solve difficult issues. There was some conversation about decreasing the level of acrimony, and as you've talked about today, you referred to it as improving civility. But there was also some talk about breaking bread and getting together in the same room. I presume the Western Governors Association provides some opportunity for that, and I want to refer you to two of the items that you mentioned. The struggle you're having in getting wind power from Wyoming, where it's generated, across, I think, Utah and Nevada to California, where it could be purchased and used. But for transmission line difficulties, I know you've been a number of years in that process, or someone's been a number of years in that process. And similarly, the topic we discussed this afternoon, trying to get Wyoming coal across the West by rail to an opportunity for Pacific export. In each case, there are other governors involved. In each case, there are federal governments involved. What's the opportunity for a dialogue there and a more cohesive voice coming out of the discussion?
Well, it's, I think the Western governors is the right place to do it. It's, you know, it's allowed me, for example, I've gone out and visited with Governor Brown of Oregon and Governor Inslee, you know, one-on-one in on their home turf about this issue. As you know, I've had the occasion to go and see some of these ports. It's, you know, we do have a different point of view, and I want to take this opportunity to say, you know, I have a strong view that coal is a good deal, and they don't. They don't like it. They don't necessarily want to see it not only not used in this country, they don't want to see it exported. As I said, as the number one producer of coal, we get great benefit from that, and we have great responsibility. And I want to share with you what we're doing in Wyoming. We have, I've asked the legislature, and the legislature has provided money for what we call an integrated test center. And what we are doing is we're bolting on to a coal-fired plant, a test lab of five different bays, and we're going to take the slipstream off a coal-fired plant, and we're going to see if we can turn it into something valuable. Because that's a game changer for coal. If you can say, we are turning something that is a liability into an asset that people are lined up at the door to try to get, that is a game changer for coal, and thus it is a great benefit to all who are looking for energy sources. We've partnered with XPRIZE Foundation. They're offering a $10 million cash award to whoever figures this out. They're gonna be one of our tenants. We're gonna have other tenants. So we take this responsibility seriously so that I can go to the governors on the West Coast and say, listen, we understand your concerns. We're taking the lead in Wyoming on trying to solve this issue so that we're not talking about the CO2 emitted into the atmosphere. We're talking about the CO2 that's used as a feedstock for petrochemicals, for production of such things as graphene, certainly for enhanced oil recovery, that is there now. But we can think that we can find these solutions. I just don't accept that on something that produces 40% of your electricity, we are going to kill it. We should be looking to how to make it so it is palatable for everyone who has these concerns.
So before we adjourn, I'd just like to say a few thank yous, not least of all to Governor Mead and Senator Simpson for being with us
this evening.
Wish you'd been with us all day long, but we understand you have day jobs and other responsibilities. You're going to be on campus tomorrow, as I understand it, so
we
will see some of you here tomorrow. I want to thank our colleagues from the Bill Lane Center at CEPR, including my fellow has-been, John Chauvin, and Mark Duggan, and Bruce Kane, and the staff at both CEPR and the Lane Center for all they did to make this possible. I want to thank all the participants we had today. Two fabulous panels, in my view, and David Crane, is he still in the room? Thank you, too, David. And all of you for your interest in the West and in the Bill Lane Center and in CEPR, and we'll see you next year for the 6th annual State of the West Symposium. Thank you very much.